Welcome to the Sustainable Development eTalks series, co-hosted by CNS and Indian Institute of Management, Indore. Our guest speaker for today is Anand Grover, a noted senior Supreme Court lawyer of India and former United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health. He has also co-founded the Delhi-based Lawyers Collective, and he actively advocates for defending human rights as a lawyer. He will share with us his deep insights on access to medicines and human rights to health, which becomes all the more pertinent in the present crisis situation when we are faced with the grim reality of stockouts and non-availability of existing drugs for many illnesses, even as the scientists work frantically to find a vaccine or a treatment for COVID-19. Over to you, Anand.
Thank you very much, Shobhaji. I want to thank the Indian Institute of Management in Indore for inviting me, and also thank all the participants who are there to listen to me and interact with me. I thought I would start with the international law. And there is an international convention known as the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, which actually stipulates the right to health under Article 12. The text is there, but it has been elaborated in what is known as General Comment 14. Now, this covenant and the other covenant, in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, have been ratified by India. And in fact, they are incorporated in the Protection of Human Rights Act. So they are applicable law in India. General Comment 14, which actually elaborates this right, has very important features which we have to note. I'm not going to elaborate on all of it, but certain features, given the time limitation and the discussion that we are going to have today. One of the most important aspects of the General Comment 14 is that health services, goods and facilities must be available to everybody, especially to marginalized sections of society. And there are non-exhaustive grounds of non-discrimination, including race, color, sex, language, and we can add what we have in our constitution under Article 15 and 16. So non-discrimination is the most important aspect, but the content of the right is very important. All goods, services, and facilities must be available. What is the meaning of available? If there are 10 people who need 10 units of drugs, 10 must be available. But they cannot be available only in one area. So they have to be physically accessible to everybody. Moreover, they must be economically affordable, as also the information. They also have to be acceptable in terms of culture and medical ethics. And of course, you cannot compromise on quality at all. Importantly, the entitlements under the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights talks of entitlements to appropriate healthcare services, most importantly, community-based services, healthcare institutions, and very important for our talk today, access to essential medicines. What is the meaning of essential medicines? Essential medicines are listed by the WHO, and each country also has its own list. So periodically, India reviews its essential medicines list, and under the Essential Commodities Act, there is the Drug Price Control Order, which I'll talk about later. India has its essential medicines list, and these are perforce made available under international law as also under national law. They have to be in adequate healthcare providers and provision of education information regarding health. So basically, the content means that there has to be a functioning health system. Now, I don't have a slide, but just to tell you that unlike the civil and political rights, an example of civil and political rights are right to liberty, right not to be kept in detention without authority of law. Those are immediately enforceable. Whereas economic and social and cultural rights are not enforceable immediately. They are what are known as progressively realizable rights. But the general comment makes it clear. that though economic, social, and cultural rights generally are not enforceable immediately, there is what is known as minimum core obligations. The minimum core obligations are very important. First of all, states are required to take steps which are evidence-based and have a plan. And they have to be non-discriminatory. Once you go ahead, you can't go back. So there can't be any retrogression or non-retrogression. And as I said, minimum core obligations. Now, these minimum core obligations include access to health facilities, goods and services on a non-discriminatory basis, especially to vulnerable groups or marginalized groups. Access to minimum essential food, access to basic shelter, housing and sanitation, and adequate supply of safe and potable water. And very importantly for us, provision of essential medicines. Then equitable distribution of all health facility goods and services, and a national public health strategy or a plan of action. So you have to have a plan of action even if you can't deliver the goods immediately. That's what happened in HIV. For a long time, we didn't have medicines for HIV, but we needed to put a plan in action so that we'd be able to deliver them progressively to all sections of society. And today, for instance, they are available. Now, in India, we have incorporated the right to health under Article 21. Now, if you actually look at the text of Article 21, it doesn't talk of the right to health. In fact, it talks of a right not be deprived of your life or liberty without procedure established by law. It is the classical civil and political rights. But in India, the Supreme Court, by interpretation, held that the right to life includes the right to life, live with dignity. In the very famous case of Frances Coralie Mullin, an Irish woman prisoner who said, "I need to have access to information and newspapers in Tihar jail." So the Supreme Court says in that case that the right to life means the right to life, live with dignity. So in that case, they held that, and that was the precursor to include all the other rights, right to housing, right to life, to include right to health, right to environment. And the right to health has been held in a number of cases which I've listed now. But in a Delhi case, which is the Mohammed Ahmed minor versus Union of India, the court has gone further and included and incorporated what I said about non-derogable rights, the minimum core obligations, and the right to life consistent with human dignity, which has to be preserved. And reasonable and equitable access to life-saving medicines is critical to promote and protect the right to health. A bare minimum and to ensure that individuals have access to essential medicines. And more importantly, government cannot cite financial crunch as a reason not to fulfill its obligation to ensure access of medicines or adopt a plan of action to treat rare diseases. Because that was a case of rare diseases, especially to vulnerable and marginalized sections of society. So you see the notions which are incorporated in the right to health in Article 12, as interpreted by the General Comment 14, are now being restated by the Delhi High Court, pursuant to what has been stated by the Supreme Court in a number of cases. Now, one very important fact we have to remember is that in order to realize the right to health, the right to medicine is a very key factor. And cost of medicines, in fact, is a key factor for the cost of right of health. And in fact, the data in India shows that 70% of households have to spend out of pocket for buying drugs. And 70% is the level of people who actually have to spend. And out of the total expenditure on health, ordinarily 50% is for medicines. Now, one of the very important things that actually impacts the cost of medicines is patents. So I'm going to talk about patents, then I'll go to another topic. What is a patent? Well, patent is a monopoly. It's actually what is known as a negative right. It excludes others from making, using, selling, offering for sale, or importing a patented product or process. So patents are of two types, products and processes, and I'll tell you about that later. What is the reason? The reason ostensibly is to actually induce research and development and inventions. And the idea is that if I actually do research and development, I come out with an innovative drug in our case, I will bring it to the public. I won't keep it secret and use it myself. And that's supposed to be a bargain between the private and public interest. So the idea is to encourage disclosure of useful inventions, but the contrary disadvantage is that it actually creates monopolies. In fact, it hinders competition, and too many patents on a drug, as there are what are known as thicket of patents, in fact discourage free technology and advancement of knowledge. Prior to the patents coming in the last century, a lot of the inventions and discoveries were without patents. And in fact, there's a very serious debate, especially in the academic circles, particularly in the US, that patents are not serving the purpose of delivering innovative drugs or innovation generally. If you need to discuss and look at that, you have to just Google and you can get all the literature on that. Now, in India, we had the Patents Act in 1911, which was the old British made law. And there are two types of patents, as I said, products and processes. So the product is the ultimate product which is marketed. It has a patent over it, and the process to make it is independent, and that can have an independent patent protection. And in those days, the lifetime of the patent used to be 60 years. And because of a monopoly in the product and the process, the prices were very, very high. At the time of independence, we had some of the highest prices for medicines. But then in 1970, under the reign of Mrs. Gandhi, very important changes were made. Now, I'm a critic of Mrs. Gandhi because of the emergency. But one thing I have to give to her is that she made a very important change in patent law. She appointed people who were judges, Justice Iyengar and Justice Tegh Chand, who gave a recommendation. They said that we should not have product patent protection at all for pharmaceuticals and agrochemicals, and we should reduce the term of patent to 7 years. And that was a very small, but a very important change. What happened? Well, as I said, what is the basis of what happened? I'll talk about that first. Patents are monopolies. Because they're monopolies, they're monopolistic prices and very high cost of medicines. If you have a patent on a product, then there is an absolute monopoly because you can't make that product at all. There's no competition. But if you only have protection on processes and not on products, then you only have a relative monopoly. A competitor can walk around the process, come up with a new process. There is competition and you can have cheaper drugs. So that's what happened in India. And as an example of the price of drugs, during 1995 to 2005, when we were transitioning from the old regime to the TRIPS compliant regime, the prices of the drugs by multinational companies who had a patent, and those who are generic, are put here. And you can see the difference. The generic companies were giving drugs less than 10% of the multinational companies. Those are the prices, $2,400 per patient per month, and only $160 or $200, and similarly $1,800 to $15. So there's a huge difference, sometimes less than 5%. And because of that, India became a very important manufacturing hub for generic medicines. Prices in India became the lowest in the world. And 1988, we became exporters of pharma companies. And at the turn of the century or the millennium, Indian pharma companies were supplying 90% of the HIV drugs, generic but good quality drugs, to developing countries. Today, India has the largest pool of generic drugs, and it is coveted and sought after even by the innovative companies. Now, what is the rationale for generic companies? This is a very important chart. by Médecins Sans Frontières, or Doctors Without Borders. At the turn of the century, in 2001 or so, HIV drugs were very expensive. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, yes.
Okay. And in South Africa, there was a crisis, as in the rest of the world. And the drugs for HIV, antiretrovirals, were costing anywhere near $10,000 per year per person. And Indian drug companies, at that time, it was only the first line, triple combination therapy, three drugs had to be used. Indian companies were making them at $200 to $500. So the Cipla director, Dr. Yusuf Hamid, actually offered the drug for $220 at that time. And you know what happened? The drug prices completely plummeted, as you can see in the chart, from $10,000 to $700. And still the innovative companies, or the patent companies, or the patentees, were still selling the drugs at $700 because they were making a profit. From $700 to $10,000, you can see the profit levels. And ultimately, the prices came to $80 a month per patient. And now, they are not even $80. They're like $20, $30. So it tells you what are the cost of medicines because of patents. Now, in the 80s, what happened was, though we had a very good patent law, things started to change in the 1980s. American pharmaceutical and entertainment companies wanted to change the patent law and all intellectual property laws all over the world, like they had in the US. Very strict patent laws for developing countries. They wanted to have the patent and intellectual property laws in their own image. They started changing that through what are known as the GATT negotiations, the Uruguay round. And ultimately, they were able to push the TRIPS agreement, or the TRIPS mandate. Initially, all developing countries, led by India, actually refused to agree. But the US used very important sanction procedures. They have a law which is known as US 301 or US 301 Special, whereby they are able to impose sanctions for importing drugs into the US, or importing any product, so they can levy tariffs. Now imagine in 2000, and we were exporting software to the US, and if the US had said that we are going to impose larger tariffs on India, India would have bulked and they would have agreed to whatever the US said. And they were able to use the 301, impose or threaten to impose sanctions, and all the developing countries ultimately agreed. And they agreed to the TRIPS agreement, and India was the last one to agree. A very good book has been written on this process by Jayashree Vattal on the WTO negotiations. If you have time, please read it. And it tells you how the US is a cowboy and uses this to threaten other people to agree to what they want, like Mr. Donald Trump is doing today. For example, in the COVID arena, he wanted the drug called hydroxychloroquine. He didn't threaten anybody. He threatened to change things. That's what they do all the time. In any event, India agreed. And because they agreed, we had to change our patent law. We had to have both protection for products and processes, minimum for 20 years. And for a patent, it had to be for new drugs or new products involving what is known as an inventive step, and it is capable of industrial application. You don't need to know that. But why did we agree? Because on all these issues, we were allowed to do what we wanted in terms of what is new, what is an inventive step, what is industrial application. And we could also have a very important procedure known as compulsory licensing, which is important to reduce the prices of drugs. And also different deadlines were actually imposed for complying. Though the TRIPS agreement came into effect on 1/1/95, India was given up for 10 years to comply by 1/1/2005. Least developing countries were given time and time again, now they have to comply by 233. And they could lay down their own criteria on a number of issues. So we were able to do that. And we actually complied with the TRIPS mandate only in 2005. Now, TRIPS agreement is very different from, say, the International Covenant on Economic and Social and Cultural Rights. And it doesn't have sanctions. That is, ICESR doesn't have sanctions, but TRIPS does. If people, states do not comply with TRIPS, they are taken to the dispute panel, and we were taken to the dispute panel, and the ruling was against us on exclusive marketing rights. We went to the appellate panel and we lost, and then we had to change our law. So it has sanctions. If we don't agree, then they can enforce that by sanctions. So ultimately, we actually changed. We used the complete period, 2015. We came up with the new ideas on innovation. 3D is very important. I'll talk about that. We have pre-grant and post-grant and revocation procedures as well as counterclaim. We have compulsory licensing. And we knew that it is going to have deleterious impact, that is the patent regime with product patent, and we had to address that. Now, during that period, we were able to realize that there's something very peculiar about patents. Now, in patents for drugs, you can have a drug, which is the new compound. But not only is that patented, but its new forms are also patented. As an example on the slide, ganciclovir is the original molecule, which is patented. Then ester, which is a new form, it is also patented. Then the prodrug, and then another one, it's salt. Similarly, for ritonavir, lopinavir is patented. Two drugs are combined together, and they are also patented. Now, we realized that is the problem for us. Similarly, we also realized that a lot of drugs in the US and the European Union are patented just because they are new forms, like you saw, salts or new forms of drugs in terms of not new molecular entities, but just salts or crystalline forms and things like that. So we came up with what is new, and we came up with a section called 3D, which doesn't allow patenting of new forms of known substances unless the efficacy of that new form is significantly higher than the known substance. And the explanation says that there are certain forms which are only forms, and you have to show that they are significantly efficacious over and above the known substance. So 3D was very important. It was challenged in the Novartis case, where the Madras High Court said that this is for making sure that life-saving drugs are available. And the Novartis case was then decided in our favor and upholding it by the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court actually said that it is actually to make sure that the efficacy is not actually the physical forms, but it is therapeutic efficacy. So I've given you the physical attributes which are not considered to be therapeutic efficacy. Now, a very important part of the TRIPS agreement and also our patent law is what is known as compulsory licensing. The TRIPS agreement as well as our patent law contemplates that if there is a problem in terms of a drug not being available, then another rival company can actually approach the patent holder and ask for a voluntary license to be given. And they must make efforts to obtain a voluntary license. And if they don't get it on reasonable commercial terms and conditions, then they can go to the patent controller and try to get a compulsory license. But if they do give a license, it is known as a voluntary license, then they can work on that voluntary license. But if they don't get it, then they can go to the patent controller, and the patent controller may give the rival company a compulsory license, that is without the authorization of the patent holder, if reasonable requirements of the public are not met. So that is very important. Are there enough of the drugs which are required? That is exactly as availability. under Article 12 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights? Is it available at reasonably affordable prices? That is accessibility under Article 12. And is the patent worked in India? Meaning, is the, are the goods produced, etc. So you can get a compulsory license, or a generic company can get a compulsory license. And that is what happened at in the very famous case of Bayer versus Natco, where I was fortunate to appear, in a drug for kidney and liver cancer. And that is the first and the only case of a compulsory license in India. So that is in case of a voluntary license and in a non-emergency situation. But in an emergency situation, there are three categories where the government, without going to the patent holder, can issue what is known as a compulsory license or a government use license in the case of national emergency, extreme emergency, or public non-commercial use. And that is under 92 or section 100 of the Indian Patents Act. But there was a huge dispute about that internationally, because like the US uses US 301 to browbeat developing countries not to use the law. Therefore, the TRIPS Council clarified and reiterated that compulsory licensing provisions can be used by states in what is known as the Doha Declaration. But very few countries have been able to resort to that because of the pressures by the US. Now, in terms of that, we will discuss it when you have questions. Now, very importantly, a lot of people ask questions, but aren't the prices of the drugs very high? So I wanted to just inform you that on the prices of innovative drugs, the innovative companies will tell you that it costs about $1 billion to bring a blockbuster drug on the market. A blockbuster drug is one which fetches $1 billion as returns in 1 year. Now, there is no direct evidence available as to the cost of the drugs, because under the US law, Ralph Nader has used it, no company will give the data to let you know how much it actually costs. But there have been indirect studies, and I've given you a few studies. One is by D. Massey study. He did two studies, and that was financed by the drug companies. They accepted the study without any real scrutiny. And they found out that a lot of drugs are actually funded by public health foundations and government. And in fact, they excluded from the drug discovery the new forms of drugs, which I told you about. So the data was very flawed. And also, they did not look at marketing costs. And the marketing costs even included legal fees. They did not take into account tax breaks, which were actually available, 50% for what are known as orphan drugs. And then they came, the other studies who looked at this came to the conclusion that it is not $1 billion, but it is $200 million. And these are the two studies by US Congressional Budget Office, which is a government study, and one by a public citizen, which is an NGO. And finally, there's a study by Light and Warburton, which says a blockbuster drugs only costs $56 million, or even $22 million. But let me tell you that Novartis, in their drug Gleevec, made $1 billion as profit in the 1 year, in the first year. So you can imagine the profit rates that are actually available. So that is very important to understand, that in fact, what the drug companies tell you in terms of cost of drugs is not really true. And there's data available, literature available, to tell you what the actual cost are. In India, we have also a regime of trying to control drug prices under what is known as the Drug Price Control Order, which is issued under the Essential Commodities Act. It actually applies only to drugs that are manufactured in India and not imported. Originally, the price was fixed on cost plus, Now it is market-based after 2012. The number of drugs have been reduced from 600 to 250. Then essential medicines were brought under this list. And finally, in 2019, patented drugs for 5 years cannot be brought under drug price control order at all. So they have a holiday or exemption. So there's a major problem for patented drugs in terms of price control. So if the patented drugs are going to cost very high, what are the regimes available to the government? As I said, there is compulsory licensing, but let's see whether it has been used. And there are examples that I'm going to tell you. So in HIV, what is the experience? There are about 2 million people living with HIV. They need what are known as antiretrovirals, and they have a combination drug therapy. From 1996, there was treatment available. It was the triple combination therapy, which was first found in the US. Therefore, it was available in the US in 1996. We actually rolled it out only in 2004. Now it is available to anybody who's a person living with HIV, but it did not come without a fight. And that is one of the unique selling propositions of the HIV movement, because it is community-based. The community is very strong. They fought hard all over the world, and they've been able to procure their medicines. So today, first line, second line, and third line are available on a government program from government ART centers, as they are known. And the first line are triple combination therapy of some of the drugs. This was introduced, as I said, early in 1995-96. There were no patents in India, so they were available from generic companies, and some of the patents were rejected. Second line and third line were patented, but what happened was that the innovator companies or the patent companies actually introduced what are known as voluntary licensing. They gave voluntary licensing to Indian drug companies through the medicine patent pool or directly to them. And these drugs were then marketed all over the world. But the problem was that unlike the earlier marketing by Indian companies to every country, developing country in the world, these were restricted. And there's been a lot of dispute about that, a controversy about that. So they were not available to middle income countries like Brazil, Middle East and Northern region, Eastern Europe, etc., which were earlier markets for Indian drug companies. So because of that, and because the control is in the hands of the innovating companies, there's a lot of controversy about that, which we can discuss later on. Now, in hepatitis C, which is also a very important drug, there are 6 to 12 million people. Sofosbuvir and another few drugs, dolutegravir, valpatasvir, etc., are drugs which are available, and they are actually a cure. Now, again, voluntary licenses were given to 13 companies and excluded middle-income countries. Now, if you want to buy the drug, it's available at 54,000 rupees for a 12-week course. So it's very, very expensive. But because we have a strong generic industry in India, we are lucky that we can get it. But tuberculosis is not the same story. Now, in tuberculosis, there's a major problem because there is what is known as MDR, multi-drug resistance or extremely drug resistance TB, for which new drugs have come. The two drugs are bedaquiline and delaminate. The Indian Central Committee have approved it. WHO has recommended it. 58,000 people need bedaquiline, but these are patented medicines and they are not voluntarily licensed. The government has not issued a compulsory license. So people who need it are not getting it. So there is a major problem in terms of TB. By the way, more people are affected by TB than COVID would actually impact. As I said, bedaquiline and delaminate are very expensive, and they would cost, if the government has to provide for them, a lot of money. Today, they are being donated by the patent companies, and there are very few people who are getting it. Finally, on COVID. COVID, there are no treatment. There are few drugs which are under development. One of the key drug which was thought to be going to be working, Remdesivir, initially developed for hepatitis C, but they are trying to find out whether it will work for COVID. They were trying to use it as an orphan drug for American trials, which actually gives them a break. But there was a major controversy on that. They withdrew the application. Then there is another drug combination, which is again an HIV combination therapy, lopinavir, ritonavir. And there is, of course, the hydroxychloroquine. But none of the drugs have actually worked till now. Trials are still going on. Then there are a number of vaccines which are under trial. And the question is whether these trials, if they're efficacious, either drugs or vaccines, whether these will be available. Will they be patented? And if they will be patented, what will be the price? Will they be available to everybody who needs them? Or will they be available only to the rich people? And will the governments issue compulsory licenses? Or will the companies resort to voluntary licensing and exclude certain countries? So there are a number of challenges. And I'll stop with this last slide. There are trade sanctions. The US will use 301. Question about COVID, whether drugs or vaccine will be patented, whether the government will issue compulsory licensing or voluntary licenses will be used, and will the government have the wherewithal and the political will to fix prices under the Drugs and Prices Control Order. That's all. So I thought I'll finish here and allow you to ask questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Anand, for a very, very informative and interesting talk. Now we open for the question and answer session. Participants, please raise your virtual hands to ask your question or type in your question in the chat box. And if you have any doubts, please get them cleared right now. We already have a few questions with us. Anjali Sunil wants to ask a question. Anjali, would you like to ask yourself?
Benson.
Hello.
Hello, yes.
Yes, sir. So, under the tuberculosis, you talked about...
I can't hear you.
Drug resistance being developing. Oh. And this... hello?
Yes,
I can hear you.
Is it clearer now?
Yes,
yes. It is. Okay. So, sir, and when you were talking about the medication for tuberculosis, you had talked about developing drug resistance. And similarly, a lot of cases and research has talked about how bacteria and other viruses are mutating and drugs are becoming not effective anymore. So in this kind of a scenario, do you think compulsory licensing and the emergence of generic companies that manufacture these medication, however helpful, these companies need more research and development budgets because drugs are becoming ineffective. Do you think compulsory licensing is still the way that we need to do things?
Well, compulsory licensing is not the answer to that question, because that is to do with whether mutation is defeating the drug itself. So mutation is a very big issue in HIV. That is why you have triple combination, because the first drug would say, suppose you have, like in HIV, 100 viruses in our body. The first drug will keep 60 other viruses. So the other 40 will actually develop, and that's what is known as resistance. Then you use another drug, two drugs, the other drug will kill 30, but the 10 will survive, and the 10 will actually multiply, and then again resistance will develop. And therefore you use the third drug, which will kill 9.9, the rest of them. So 99.9% of the drugs will be killed, and they will go into the reservoirs, which is what happens in HIV. So mutation is actually dealt with by combination therapy. It's nothing to do with whether it's compulsory licensing or not. So if there is mutation, you can resort to combination therapy, and then combination would be in certain countries patented, but not in India, because that is not allowed in India under 3D. So compulsory licensing would be effective in those cases. So I hope I've answered your question. The next question is from one lady. Thailand, Malaysia, and other countries have used compulsory licensing, but they were also included in the voluntary licensing later on. So they haven't resorted to it. But also, even a threat of compulsory licenses allows for better negotiations, like in Brazil, for prices. Then there's a question from Mr. Rahul Sharma.
Yes. Can I interrupt here, Anand, for a moment?
Yes, sir.
The question from Thailand, Jitimani, she wanted to know, what are the challenges, as many countries do not use the flexibilities of trade agreements?
Yes.
So please help us understand that, she wants to know.
Number of flexibilities are there. Like I mentioned in the slides, you can look at that again.
Right.
All the opposition procedures, the type of pattern you have, 3D is another one, 3E is another one, the transition period, etc. Now, in Thailand, they had a provision for compulsory license, but a lot of countries don't have it, like Germany and Brazil don't have it. Now they've introduced a change. So those are flexibilities. Those flexibilities have to be written into your law, and TRIPS allows it. Those flexibilities have to be utilized. It doesn't tell you what are the grounds for compulsory licensing. So you can actually make your own grounds, except they have to be within the parameters like emergency, extreme emergency, or public non-commercial use. But you can have your own grounds, like under 84 of our Act, we have said that compulsory licenses on a non-emergency situation will be on reasonable requirements of the public not being met, reasonable affordable prices, and the pattern not worked in India. This is a flexibility. So these are things that the country can use. Rahul Sharma's
yes.
Question is, the Epidemic Act, the Epidemic Diseases Act is a fraught legislation. It's an old legislation, and it is not available, for example, in the erstwhile non-British states like Rajasthan. And also each state has made their own amendments. The center has its own. There's a bit of a problem. I think the Epidemic Diseases Act has to be completely revamped. But as you rightly say, we need to, with the enforcement of the Epidemic Diseases Act, all the rights which are attended to the right to life, including the right to food, have to be also enforced. We had a very sorry state of affairs in that migrant workers, 20 million of them or so, were forced out of their jobs and they had to trek, and they are not able to go to their houses. So that's a very sad state of affairs. We need to look into that. And you can't have enforcement of such acts without other rights being actually looked into and being realized. The next question is from Mr. Yadav. Doesn't a national lockdown, affect the poor? Indeed, it does. It's actually a gross interference with the right to life and liberty. I agree with what you're saying. There's a very important saying which has been touted by Mr. Bill Gates and a lot of people all around the world, that the virus doesn't discriminate. Well, that's true to an extent, but the virus exposes the inequality in society. So the rich and poor, caste differences, inadequate housing. So Dharavi actually cannot maintain social distancing. In their person living in a room of 10 by 10 has 6 to 8 people, and that exposes them to more infection than a person living in, I'm at my house now in a flat which is luxurious in Bandra, overlooking the sea. So I'm a privileged person compared to person living 5 kilometers from here in Dharavi. So though it doesn't discriminate in terms of infection, but they are disproportionately affected in terms of the number of infection, the rate of infection, and the consequences that are attended to such infection. Namely, they are not able to work. They can't go to a job. A lot of them are daily wage earners, so they don't get their wages. If they are privileged to be working in a government company, they get their wages. But otherwise, they lose their wages. And unlike England, where the government has funded 80% of the wages through employers for a month or 3 months, in India, we haven't done that. We have no money except a measly 500 rupees and rations for poor people. And it is affecting them very, very badly. So you're absolutely right. But unfortunately, none of these cases have been taken up by the Supreme Court because I don't know what the reason is. But that's a sad state of affairs.
Thank you. I just want to say again to our participants, please raise your virtual hand if you want to ask your question yourself or type it. Better if you ask yourself, perhaps, but if still you can type it in the chat box also. And I think we have a question from Manushesh Mishra, who's a High Court lawyer from Lucknow. He wants to ask the question. Manushesh, would you like to ask your question yourself? Okay, well, maybe some technical problem. While we wait for him, I have a question which was sent to me earlier by a student from IIM Indore. And he says, forget about COVID, but even in normal times, you have said that there has to be no discrimination while dispensing health services. But still, there is a lot of stigma and discrimination towards LGBT and transgender communities. So it also exists at workplace and in educational institutions. How does one tackle this?
Well, that's a very important question. Not only LGBTQI communities, all sets of marginalized groups face discrimination, transgender persons, LGBTQI, poor people. And if you are from a particular state in Maharashtra or in any other state, you know, the problem is that discrimination is rife in every country against all communities and even sex workers, against sex workers because of the association of practices. Now, as far as transgender persons are concerned, there is now a law which actually gives them rights, but rules have just been drafted. We were a party to the rules drafting once the rules come in, you can try to enforce it. And then you will have, if you're a transgender person, a transgender certificate and ID card, and you can enforce your rights under the Act if you are discriminated as a transgender person. But two things I have to say. One is that discrimination or equality and discrimination is addressed by the Constitution in Articles 14, 15, and 16. But these articles are only applicable to what are known as state entities. Those entities which are controlled or under the authority of the state. They may be finance or administratively controlled by the state, but they are not applicable to private entities. For example, Lawyers Collective is a private entity. If I, as a Lawyers Collective director, were to discriminate against an LGBTQI person, they won't be able to go to court and address that. So what is required and what we were able to do in the HIV Act is to allow for addressing of discrimination on the grounds of HIV against private entities also. And that is also done in the Transgender Act against private entities, but not for all people. So you can't go to a court and say, I'm a gay man and a private industry is discriminating against me as a gay person. So we need an equality or an anti-discrimination law for this in the private sector. It's a very important right that we have to gain. It is available in the Constitution against the state entities, but not against private persons. So I hope I've answered that question. Next question is...
Can I interrupt, Anand? Because there is a question in continuation to that, again from an IIM student, that although Section 377 has been repealed in India, but as you said, discrimination, you agreed discrimination against sexual minorities still exists. He says that, the question says that usually very often the discrimination comes from inside the family of the person. And it is not easy in India to take a legal stand against families. As a lawyer, what do you think we are citizens of the country that promotes tolerance should keep in mind and at least actually be tolerant?
Well, you know, the problem is, and in these very important areas of marginalized groups facing discrimination, it is sometimes in the home that one faces the worst type of discrimination.
Right.
So to address that is not an easy task in law. We tried to do that in the HIV Act and to some extent in the Transgender Act. But in the Transgender Act, Parliament actually reversed our suggestion, and we have a very difficult situation there. Now, the only way we can address that is by having counseling centers and legal advice centers where an LGBTQI person can take advice and try to address that problem in the home. But it's not very easy, and the law doesn't really help us there. So I'm sorry, but we have to be able to, as I said earlier, enact a law for discrimination generally. Even, you know, we have a law for domestic violence.
Yes.
But I mean, that actually Lawyers Collective was again the architect in that. And it's a fairly successful law. But as you know, in COVID, domestic violence has risen. Yes. And there hasn't been much addressing of that. The next question, if I may.
Yes, Shabaji, please. Yes, yes.
Is by Ms. Shriya Rawal.
Yes.
She says, constitutional rights of poor and vulnerable have been affected. Isn't this a constitutional duty, not a social and moral responsibility? And can they escape to dilute? No, again, you know, as I said, the law hasn't addressed it. So at the societal level, we can change. Like, for example, today, HIV is not a major issue because we have done a lot of advocacy and sensitization. There is discrimination, but more so in COVID. So we have to do sensitization again and again. The other question is by Mr. Yadav. No, I've already answered that actually, sorry. Yeah, that's it. Is there any other question?
Yes, I think I'm asking once again, because this is your last chance to ask the question since we are coming to the close of the session. So please raise your virtual hand or quickly type in your questions. Meanwhile, I have a question, Anandji. That you were talking of the arm twisting tactics of the US, and because of that, India is exporting hydroxychloroquine to them. At the same time, there are reports that India might stop export of TB drugs to other countries.
Sorry, what is the last point? It is?
That India is exporting hydroxychloroquine to US.
Correct.
But at the same time, there is a news that it will stop the export of TB medicines to other countries, given the lockdown situation in the country. And
we are not producing any TB, the new TB drugs, bedaquiline and delaminate. We're producing all the older ones.
Yes, it is about the old ones only that they will stop. They are exporting it to other countries also.
Yes. But the new drugs, which are very, very important, are the MDR and XDR TB,
right.
They can stop them, but I don't think they'll stop them because we have adequate supply of them,
mm-hmm.
and they are not really needed on COVID because the only drug which was really being tested is hydroxychloroquine, and all the data shows that it is not working. But we don't know, it may work. We are still in the early stages. But the Prime Minister, it wasn't arm twisted. It was like, I think they were told by Mr. Trump that we want it. And there was a threat, which is the normal way of the US reacting, and particularly the US president, Mr. Trump. But Mr. Modi made a calculated guess. Correctly, the government of India realized that they have an adequate stock of hydroxychloroquine, and any company which sells it will make a lot of money. So for them, it was a win-win situation and not an altruistic gesture. But it came across as an altruistic gesture, which is good image building for India. And particularly for Mr. Modi. but that drug is not effective. And in fact,
yes.
It has cardiac issues, which is now coming out in the open.
Yes. And I just wanted to share here, Anand, in one of our previous sessions, Meena Seshu of Sangram. She runs this collective.
Yes, I know Meena.
You must be knowing her. And she had said, the day she was speaking in the session, she said only today morning a sex worker committed suicide out of that fear that she was not able to earn anything. And she was very scared of what is going to happen. So rightly, as you have said, that the virus knows, does not discriminate, but our system really does discriminate between people and how the virus affect any virus or any disease affects them.
The virus actually exposes the inequality that is prevalent in society.
Right. So I think now we have, we are running out of time.
There's one question.
Okay. Yes. Yes, please.
This is from somebody, Alison Taylor, or it's a private question.
Alison, would you like to ask yourself, if she would like to ask herself? Alison, would you? Okay, you can answer it. Yes. Yes, Anand, you can answer. Just read the question and answer it.
Hi, it's Alison Taylor here. No, I was just paying tribute to the event and to your speaker. I work for a lung health charity, which is headquartered in Paris, but I'm based in the UK. And the topic this morning has been absolutely fascinating. And the transparency, sir, in which you're able to give the information, I found absolutely essential to someone like me working for a lung health charity, which although we are headquartered in India, headquartered in Paris, we also have an office in India, and it will very much help me with my work. So it was just a message to say thank you very much, particularly explaining the situation with TB and MRTB drugs.
Alison, I'm familiar with the union. I work very closely with the TB groups in India. So thank you for your comments.
Okay. Thank you very much. We come to the end of today's discussion. Our sincere thanks once again to Anand Grover for finding time despite his very, very busy schedule. And I think we all need to thank him. So we want to hear a lot of thank yous from our participants. Yes.
Thank you, Shobhaji.
Yes.
And thank you, audience. Thank you
very much. And goodbye to
the meeting. Thank you, sir.
So a bouquet of thank yous and goodbye till we meet again on Monday, April 27 at 2:30 p.m. to hear from Aditi Ghosh of IPPF on the plight of refugees and others facing humanitarian crisis. So please stay safe and have a restful weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you.